שעת תולדות, תולדות. So, it's a very cool parasha. I want to talk about what we get about this parasha for ourselves, but I need to bring out and tell you that it's a very important parasha in terms of what we could learn for ourselves, in terms of what we could learn about our married life, and in terms of what we could learn about education to kids. I do need to tell you that some of the things here will be conflicting, will be contradicting one another, because I want to bring different opinions and different views to look at things, and so on and so forth. But overall, there is a certain line that guides us through this parasha, is that basically nothing is written in stone, as they say. It's all opposites and all balagan like this. So we know that our forefathers, our foremothers are always a model for us, especially in their behavior to what we and how we should conduct ourselves, right? Whether it's Abraham, we say bizrizut and quickness and so on and so forth. But however, here in our parasha, it talks about the almost battling or disagreement between Yitzchak and Rivka, and then whatever and how did they dealt with here with Esav, and quite problematic. It's not that I don't have words, believe me, I wrote way too much here. However, it's very sometimes very hard for me to talk about things like this, but I really, as they say, want to put it on the table and then we'll see where it takes us. It's going to be some contradiction to what I'm saying. It's not that I know this from the beginning. I will say one thing and then I'll say something opposite. But I hope I'll be able to make sense. So in every, you know, if you go to, right before you get married, before, you know, getting married, you know, you go to chasam classes, kala classes, whatever you do, everybody is teaching you that the best thing to do, the most important to do for a healthy relationship is to always bring about things and talk, talk about things between the couple. And it seems like that the most common, I mean, we know that Esav has a problem. We know that Esav has a problem. Or at least we think that Esav is problematic. All these years, I still did not get over the fact that we always like to portray Esav as a horrible person, and I do believe that because of that, we miss a lot of what we can learn about dealing with ourselves and dealing with our own kids. Okay, so but it, you don't see that they're actually talking about each other, to each other about their son, and why didn't they do so? That's certain problems we have here. Then we have a peculiar behavior of Rivka. Rivka is doing what? She's trying to persuade Yaakov to steal the brachot? And what does it mean? I mean, altogether, is it possible b'chol to steal a bracha? Who gives the bracha? Who gives the bracha? HaKadosh Baruch Hu gives the bracha. The person who gives the bracha is just the vessel. So, HaKadosh Baruch Hu doesn't know, HaKadosh Baruch Hu Chas V'Shalom is also blind. You know who the bracha goes to. So, it's problematic. We have Yitzchak as a very noble figure, and it seems like Yitzchak is completely disconnected from reality. He has no touch with what's going on. He's out there somewhere, not realizing what's going on. You know, he didn't know that, as they say, quote unquote, Esav is pulling a fast one on him. It's so removed. I don't know that. It's a little difficult for me to think so. And even if he thinks that Esav deserves a brachot, why does he want, as they say, give him a tremendous bracha? Is mital hashamayim u'mishamnei haaretz, from the dew of the heaven and the oils of the ground. I mean, it's bizarre. It doesn't make sense. Give the good bracha to the good kid. You give the good bracha to the bad kid. Doesn't make sense. And if Yitzchak was so suspicious that the person who stands in front of him is not Esav, right? He says, "Are you Esav, my son?" And you know, he feels his hand. Say, "Akol kol Yaakov, ayadayim yedei Esav." The hands are Esav. The voice is is Yaakov, you know, excuse me, what's the big deal? Ding, 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 Medela, somebody please come here. Can you tell me, please, let's say he doesn't see. Can you please, and I do say, let's say he doesn't see. I don't believe that that's the case. But let's say so. But excuse me, you don't know who it is. Call somebody to help you. Rivka, Avienzi, come over here. Vus is Dus, Kenneth Este, Yankele, okay. Who is this? Tell somebody, call one of your servants, somebody. This is bizarre. It's bizarre. So we need to know that, let's go back to the beginning. These are some problems that we have. That the beginning of the parasha is almost like an introduction. You know, like in a book, you have a preference, you know, like you have an introduction to what is going to be written in the book. And this is a parasha. And the parasha says, and the Torah says, Ve'ele toledot Yitzchak ben Avraham. This is the story of Billy the Kid. This is the story of Yitzchak ben Avraham. Avraham ulid et Yitzchak. Thank you very much. I know that Avraham ulid et Yitzchak. Yofi. Ve'i Yitzchak ben 40 shana bekachto et Rivka b'Betuel Arami. And she was 40 years old when he took her to a wife. Gezuntahed. Right? I mean, it says that Mipadam Aram achot lavan Arami lo leisha. That, okay, rega. There's a little bit of a problem here. So first of all, the description that we have about Yitzchak is very condensed, right? Avraham ulid et Yitzchak, and so on and so forth, right? And it seems in a way that throughout the life of Yitzchak, as it seems here, it seems like Yitzchak is a very passive figure. Okay? What do I mean? The Akedah, right? What happened to the Akedah? His father says, lay down on the stone. He says, okay, pops, no problem. I lay down on the stone. Yitzchak is laughing at him. I mean, as Ishmael is laughing at him. Go to Ishmael, you know, headbutt him. Do something. I mean, flip him. Beat him up. Tell your daddy, do something. I mean, do something. Yitzchak is laughing at him. Oh, that's a little laugh at me. I don't really care. You know, it's very sad, you know. You bring him a favorite woman, right, to him. He doesn't say, oh, my manavu alearim, raglea, you know, nothing. He just says, okay, come, please, to the tent, so, you know, here it is, open the door, mi casa tu casa, that's it, the end of the story. The whole entire thing. It seems like, again, I do have to tell you that Yitzchak is maybe the most underestimated figure of all the patriarchs that we have. But there is a reason why. I'm about to tell you what he did. It's a totally different perush, but I'm saying to you what it seems on the surface, right? Yitzchak doesn't go and digs his own wells. Where does he go? He goes and digs the wells in which his father digged, right? When you introduce Rivka, it's a little longer, right? And all of a sudden, you know, how many times you can say Arami? Bat Betuel, Arami, Achot Lavan, Ha'arami. Why doesn't it say Ve'ele toldot Yitzchak ben Avraham Micharan? I mean, say something about that. Why isn't Sarah mentioned here? And the emphasis is on, it seems to me, is on Ha'arami. By the way, if you take the word Arami, Aleph Resh Mem Yud, you mix it up, what do you get? Ramai. Right. Ramai is a crook. I mean, I don't know about you, but I would say, are you trying to say something? So if you're trying to say something, why won't you just say it? It seems to me like somewhere along the line, Rivka is not being portrayed in such a positive light. Rivka bat Betuel ha'arami, achot lavan, Ha'arami. Say, Bat Betuel, Achot Lavan. Right? And there is, I guess, something that has to do with that, and we have to see. Yitzchak Avinu knows exactly who he's dealing with, right? He's not. And I keep saying all the time, everybody always concentrates about Avraham, Lech Lecha, Bo Lecha, and so on and so forth, Yaakov Avinu. But the main character of us is really always is Yitzchak, he's the middle, but Yitzchak knows exactly what's going on here. Yitzchak wanted, had he knew right away who Esav is, and he wanted to, basically prepared all his life to try to be machzir b'tshuva his son, to bring him back on the path. And the Torah says that Yitzchak tried by embracing him, he loves him, he didn't make him feel, you know, people, we always like to say, oh, he was bribed. Ah, Yitzchak Avinu was into shish kabab. Bemet, no, bemet. Yitzchak Avinu was into shish kabab. Yitzchak Avinu liked to go, oh, go fetch me some deer, my dear son. I feel like eating something. Yitzchak, nah, we're missing it. Yitzchak is trying to give his son a certain sense of love. You're important, I love you. He doesn't want to lose him, right? So he doesn't want to lose him. He's basically trying to show him that, listen, Esav, you also have a part in the family. You're important also. I love you. And not push him away. And it seems to me like Esav in return, also trying to, you know, have a relationship with his father. Apparently it didn't really work. But you see, they're trying to communicate. So Yitzchak maybe had an idea that what he wanted to achieve is some kind of a contract of a concept of Yisachar and Zvulun. He understood that the kids were a little different, right? So he says Esav will be the Zvulun, Esav will be the merchant, will be the outside man, and Yaakov will be the inside man. And like this, we have a complete harmony. Because you can't have just a person sitting down learning without somebody supporting him. And you can't support, I mean, you can't work. Yeah, you hear me? You can't work without learning because you're not going to make it, right? So he really wanted to do so, and because of that, because he knew that Esav is going to deal more with the practical sides of life. I mean, that's why he wanted to give him mital hashamayim mishamnei haaretz. He's going to do how in the world he's going to do business? He's going to invest in stocks, in oil. You know, going to do some business. So he gave him the appropriate bracha, and Yaakov here is taking the bracha and is stealing it from him, and we'll see, maybe he creates some kind of a chaos in the world, right? So you see that throughout the life, Yitzchak prepares Esav for this almost ceremony of inauguration to become a good boy again. I'm about to die, come home to daddy, I'll give you a bracha, get dressed, and so on and so forth, right? And receiving the brachot, therefore, he's explaining him exactly what he needs to do. And how does he do so? He does it by saying something very interesting. If you go to hunt, right? Am I allowed to go to hunt in your farm? No, I'm allowed to go outside. Why? Because it's a hefker. So he wants to make sure that the brachot will come to initiation of something good. So go do the right thing. Go get something to the hefker, right? And therefore, by doing so, remember all the rules, ben adam lemakom, ben adam lechavero, and so on and so forth. He shows him that even in materialistic matters, there is room for order. Our reality has to be according to the laws of the Torah. And there is order in materialistic world as well. It's not like you do whatever you want to survive. There's laws, there's order. There's a certain attitude that you should have as well. Yitzchak is really hoping that to this ceremony, his son would really become Chozer B'tshuva. That's when Yaakov comes and he's dressed up, Yitzchak did not ask anybody to come and verify that this is Esav, right? Why? Because he says Shem Shamayim Shagur Bifiv, as the Midrash tells us. He has Shem Shamayim Bifnim, right? And that was probably, he says, oh, my son, Yadayim Yadei Esav, Kol Kol Yaakov. It's a different way to look at it. Oh, maybe my son really made tshuva, right? He made a bracha. He realized he's coming home. We always look at it one way because we got used to see it one way. But this is another way to look at it. Now, according to that, we have Rivka. And we always say that Rivka's prophecy was higher than Yitzchak's prophecy. And she knows exactly what's to come out, because that was also that she was told in the Bet Medrash of Shem and Ever, and so on and so forth. Right? But they did, you know, they Shem ve'ever. I mean, today we go into the doctor or we go into the clinic and they tell you, oh, you have a boy, you have a girl, you do what you call it, ultrasound, right? In Shem ve'ever, they tell you what's going to be the spiritual ultrasound. They did like a spiritual ultrasound. Sam, sit like this so you can see. Like a spiritual ultrasound of what the going to be with this guy. So she knew exactly. She knew exactly what's going to be. And since prophecy like this was given, as the Medrash tells us before Matan Torah, that she was not allowed to reveal it to anyone. It was only told to her, it was not revealed to anyone. So she knows exactly what is going to be good and so on and so forth. She took care of Esav as a good mother. She gave him love and affection. Esav felt the same thing to his mother. That's why when he has the Bigdei Chamudot, that the special clothing that he got from Adam HaRishon, he doesn't give it in the hands of his wives, he gives it in the hand of his mother, right? Because he knew, he believed her, she was good and she loved him, and he felt that, so he trusted her and so on and so forth. So with these two different perspectives about lives, Yitzchak and Rivka were living. So therefore we say that if we could say, this is one side of it, that if we want an appropriate shidduch, appropriate relationship, they did exactly what they did, what you need to do, which is really talk about it. He said one thing, she said the other thing, and then discuss it. Says, okay, we have a problem with a kid. Let's embrace him with love. Let's not blame somebody else for this. Let's not blame, you know, the school we sent him to. This is our kid. He came from us. We need to do what we can to embrace him and hug him. That's why when parents criticize their problematic kid, they're not taking responsibility for their actions. They're dumping the responsibility on anybody else besides themselves, and which they, it's basically their fault. It's their fault. So, you know, they understood that. But how to actually execute it, there are different schools of thought. He thought to educate him. They talked about that. We have a problem we have to do. But how to do it, that's where they were off. Yitzchak held one thing. There is hope for him. We embrace him, it will be good, and so on. She said, no, that's going to be, that's what it is. You know, we have to minimize the damage. He says, no, we could turn it. So therefore, there's a pedagogic argument of how to apply those methods of education to this kid. So for that, they weren't on the same page. And it says, the Pasuk says, Ve'igdelu ha'na'arim ve'yeh Esav ish yodei atzai de'ish sadeh. They got older, and Esav was a hunter, a man of the field. Ve'yakov ish tam yoshev o'alim. You have to pay so much attention to that. Because this is one of the psukim that if you look at it appropriately, and hopefully by the end of the shiur today, you'll see why it's so important. We always mess it up so much, and there's such a big lesson to learn from this. Oh, you, there's such a big lesson to learn. Again, Esav ish yodea tzaid ish sadeh, a man of the field. Ve'yakov ishtam yoshev o'alim. Ve'yohav Yitzchak et Esav hitzaid b'fiv ve'rivka ohevet et Yaakov. And this is the beginning of the tragedy. Every loving parent, every parent, should we say that, loves a different kid here. He has his favorite, and this is a different view, right? This is a different view. And she has her favorite, right? And this is, by the way, not accidental. We know that everybody, subconsciously, to most of the time, we're looking always for somebody or for something that we don't have. Sometimes we look for it in our spouses. I'm looking in my spouse for something that I don't have, or I'm looking in my son something that I don't have. That's why many times parents who make the crucial mistake of trying to push their kids to do what they wanted to do, not allowing the kid to do what they want to do. It's a huge mistake. Huge. Huge mistake. You had your chance as a parent. You had your chance. You didn't do it. Leave your kid alone. If you wanted to be a doctor, so go and become a doctor. I know somebody who started medical school was 60 years old. Okay. So you can go to medical school. You didn't go to medical school. Why you push your kid? Your kid wants to be a mechanic. Let him be a mechanic. He doesn't want to go to... What's wrong with a mechanic? I'll tell you the truth. I'll tell you the truth, honestly. If I had to choose between a doctor and a mechanic, I'll take a mechanic. It's more interesting. More interesting.
So you mean if you push your kid to be a doctor, like to be a lawyer,
which
mistake?
Yeah. Why? That's what I said. Why? Because you need to ask the kid what he wants to be, not what you want him to be. You had your chance. You should try to give your kid the tools to be able to identify hold on. He asked me a question. You have to be able to give your kids the tools to identify what he's good at and what he wants, but don't push him to do what you didn't do. That's a mistake. That's a mistake. It's an educational mistake. And Rivka, they came from a house, from a family of tough shepherds, right? They were tough shepherds. Right? What did she in her family who survived? Only the wicked, the crooked, and the strong one survived, right? She connects to the kid that represents to her what she wanted to be. Ishtam. Because that's what she is, right? She wanted a house that's going to be a sensitive house, a gentle house. Right? She just took the opposite of what she wanted, right? The same thing, Yitzchak, the passive one, right? Who always goes in the path that his father wanted him to be, express his behavior, right? Or his desire by embracing Esav, which is the Isha Sadeh, the man of the field, the hunter, the materialistic guy, the dominated guy. Ishmael was more dominant than Yitzchak. So look what he did, you know, which is very natural and yet tremendously tragic. In psychology, we call this displacement. Displacement. It's a term in psychology. You're trying to sometimes put your wills on somebody else or put your problems or whatever it is. You displace, you take it from this and you're putting it there. You couldn't do it, you make him do it. You have to see. You have to see what the person is. And that's the most important lesson. We forget that we're dealing here with people and they are different than us. Even though they are our children, they are different than us. They have their own chemistry. After all, they're not clones. There's another party, and that party created a different person. Whether it's your wife or your husband, but it created a different person. So it cannot be you. You cannot live your life. You cannot, and you shouldn't, live your life through somebody else's life. If you have a problem, you have an unachieved goal in your life, if it's important enough, go do it. For example, you want to dive the Great Barrier Reef. You couldn't do it. So go do it. Who's stopping you? Or as they say, you want to kiss a stranger on a hotel balcony. Go ahead and do that. Who's stopping you? That's what you want to do. Go. You want to have a croissant and espresso in a Paris and eat a baguette. Go ahead and do it. Who's stopping you? But don't tell your son that that's what he needs to do because you couldn't do it. Make sure the son, give him the tools to be able to identify what he wants, what he needs, and to be able to say, don't be afraid. Go do it. Go do what you want to be. Give him the tools. Don't live your life through him. And this is we do this all the time to try to fill up the gaps of different things that are missing in our personality, in our experience to somebody else. And it's a very common dynamics in parenthood where the kids are becoming an instrument to fulfill our dreams, our desires that we couldn't do. And that is going to affect the way we interact through our kids or with our kids. If the kid doesn't do what I wanted for myself, so we become upset at him and we become whatever at him, and that changes the whole dynamics and the future of this child. You have no idea to what extent. Many times, if you have a kid that resembles in his behavior you exactly, and he makes similar mistakes because you direct them to do that, you get angry at him instead of getting angry at yourself. Tell him, my son, you're exactly like me. These are the mistakes that I made. You shouldn't make them. Don't push him to where, because when you push somebody, the first thing you do, he resists. So you're never going to achieve anything like that. Now, you know, whether it's, and you see that to a certain extent, there are certain things that happen between Esav and Yaakov, and you never hear the parents, anything that the parents say, even buying the Bechorah, the whatever, the firstbornness. How would you call the Bechorah in English? How would you say it?
Firstborn right.
That's a different term. You know, yeah, firstborn right, whatever it is. They don't say anything. You don't hear the parents, Vayomer Yitzchak el Esav, Beni Esav Yakiri, that's your brother, you know, get rid of, you know, deal with him and be nice to him, give an example. Or he said, no, I sold him. What do you mean you sold? Nothing. You see from Yitzchak and Ishmael, Rivka goes and say, Allah, throw him out of here, and so on and so forth. Yaakov has a problem with his sons. He tells him. He has a problem with his sons. He tells him. Shimon and Levi, and he goes ahead and tells him. Yitzchak and Rivka don't say anything. That's also a problem. All these things are written for us to learn. Chas v'shalom to criticize our avot and imaot. Good afternoon. Chas v'shalom to criticize them. But I'm saying the reason why the Torah wrote it is for us to learn what not to do, because we make the same mistakes. So, now a different point of view. It could be that really Yitzchak did not see, and Rivka was able to see things better. And she's trying to tell her husband, honey, listen, he's pulling a fast one on you. You better watch out. And she's trying to tell him. She can't tell him that straight out. She doesn't speak Rosh Hashanah. So she's trying to hint it to him. Therefore, she chose a certain type of a facade to put on, right? And saying that their relationship is perfect. She knows exactly what Yitzchak wants. She knows exactly. They know each other very well. They love each other. So she's making him the food exactly how the way it should be, the way he likes it, and so on and so forth. And she said, you know, you don't need to have a special hunting animals for that. You could really do so, by knowing the person very well. And she tells her son, she commanded him, go ahead and bring it to your father, go fetch it. And Yaakov is ishtam, he's afraid of his father cursing him, and he says, I don't want my father to curse me. He says, no, you go ahead and do it, don't worry about it, I know what I'm doing. And if you look at what she gave him, she brought him what we call Shnei Seirim. Shnei Seirim, what does it say here? Baby goats, Gdaim, right? She brought him two Gdaim. Just like as they do in Yom Kippurim, that they have to be exactly, you know, they have to be identical exactly. You can't have one white and one with patches. So they have to be identical, right? And one is for Hashem and one is Lazazel, right? And the which one we actually invest more? In the one that goes to the Azazel, the one that not for Hashem. This is, by the way, according to Rav Hirsch, that's what he writes. So she's trying to give him a hint. Habibi, my dear husband, there's something going on here. Open your eyes. Yom HaKippurim, Shnei Seirim. And Rivka knew also, Yitzchak knew that he's a tzaddik. And if he's going to find out what his wife did, he's not going to scream and yell and throw things around and do Kramer versus Kramer. He's not going to do all these things, right? But on the contrary, she knows him, and she knows he's going to give Yaakov a bracha as well. And so is exactly what Yitzchak is doing. And he says, you know, look at the Perek Chav Zayin, Pasuk Lamed Daled over there, that's what he says. So Rivka knows that brachot you don't steal. You don't steal the bracha. You can't steal a bracha from someone. You get exactly what you need to get. By the way, it's not only in bracha, it's in anything else in life. Therefore, there's no room to steal anything from anyone. You get what you get. Let's say, Chas v'shalom, I stole Yitzchak's telephone. That doesn't belong to me, does not deserve me. Somewhere along the line, I'm not going to have a lot of atzlacha. This phone's going to give me a curse, Chas v'shalom, who knows what? That's not yours. There's no room to steal. You can't steal. It's not yours. It's not yours. You get exactly what you need to get. No more and not less. That's where emunah comes about, and accepting and understanding that everything comes from HaKadosh Baruch Hu, whether it's a little, whether it's a lot, it does not make a difference. Just the fact that it came from HaKadosh Baruch Hu, there is a lot of bracha carrying in that. When you acknowledge that something came from HaKadosh Baruch Hu, Right? So it definitely doesn't make a difference. Okay, so Yitzchak got himself a... what'd you get yourself? A Ford F-150 Raptor. Not from aluminum. And I got myself a Toyota Tacoma 1988. So I should be jealous of him. No. Where did I get my Tacoma? I have a Mustang, right? But where did I get my Tacoma? Where did I get my Tacoma? It's a 2000 Mustang. GT. Where did I get my Tacoma? For me? No, I'm not able to generate anything. Everything comes from HaKadosh Baruch Hu. So HaKadosh Baruch Hu gave me a gift. So that's my gift. And you know what? You keep your gift and I keep my gift. I don't want your gift. That's mine. He comes from HaKadosh Baruch Hu. I should be jealous of him? Yes, if I'm stupid. So you have a big house, I have a small house. I should be jealous of you? No, I'm lucky. Why? Everywhere I look, I see my wife. You don't want to call your wife, hello? You hear, hello, hello, hello. You know? Nobody's home. So, why? Because I understand that I got it from HaKadosh Baruch Hu. I'm happy. It's a gift. Let me ask you a question. Let's say one day you'll be able to actually meet face to face with the Presidente of the United States in Shish Kabab, right? The President, you and him in the Oval Office, okay? And let's say, see, he would not give you a cigar. I would not take it either. Who knows who left it there? But let's say he gives you something insignificant. Gives you a pen, okay? A pen. It says there, to my dear friend so-and-so, President of the United States, and so on and so forth. With a pen. The pen costs, I don't know, $10. But would you ever give this away? For you, so you give it to your great-grandson. Say, this I got, my great-grandfather got it from the President of the United States. It's a pen, it's worth $10. But there's something, because you understand who gave it to you. So therefore, the monetary value of it is insignificant, more than who gave it to you. If you able to recognize whatever you got, that you got from HaKadosh Baruch Hu, therefore there's not a problem. So therefore, brachot you cannot steal, Rabotai. You cannot steal brachot. So, she knows that. So she knows that you cannot steal the brachot, and she counts on her husband to be who he is, to give her a bracha, and so does Yitzchak. And this is the test, this is the real test. When Yitzchak was hoping all his life to this partnership of Yisachar and Zvulun, he's basically, by giving the bracha to Yaakov, admitting that she was right. In her conclusion, she was right. Therefore, in that moment, as the Medrash tells us, petach shel geinom patuch lefanav, he saw the gates of hell opening in front of him. And that hope for partnership, for fruitful partnership, I guess he realized that we'll have to wait for some later time in history. Right? It's not going to be now. It's going to be further down in history. And what we're talking about, Yisachar and Zvolun, is not even the Yisachar and Zvolun, thank you so much. It's not even the Yisachar and Zvolun of the tribes, the Yisachar and Zvolun of Esav taking care of Yaakov, but then it will have to be the end of time, so he has to wait. He understands that. And there's a conclusion that he knows that she was right. And he's okay with that. I should show you an example. If you have an argument in your relationship, and you know that you are wrong, you say, okay, you know what, I was wrong. Okay, fine, not a problem. Thank you, my wife. Thank you, my whoever, that opened my eyes to me to show me that I was wrong. But you would rather be, you know, win the argument and be wrong the rest of your life, or to lose the argument and to live the right way? Of course, the second. That's for fools, the other ones. And most people are fools, by the way. So, look at what is happening here. We have Yitzchak, that really established Tfilat Mincha, that really takes Mincha, comes in the middle of the day. In the middle of the day, everybody's busy working and so on and so forth. Is basically a symbol of dealing with the daily reality, with planting and harvesting and so on and so forth, dealing with a problematic child. And the Torah really wants to show us how appropriately to deal with such issues, with a bad son and so on and so forth, to an extent that maybe today that's what they implement in schools, in terms of, we say, Chanoch, as it says in Mishlei, Chanoch lanar lefi darko, you have to educate the son according to his to who he is, not to what you want. In other words, when we create the sardine can syndrome, right? We take kids who are interested in different things, and we chop the legs, and we chop the tails, and we chop the head, and we put them all in the sardine can, and then we mass produce people. We lose the identity of the person. Everybody has to learn the same thing the same way. And it's not like this. You know, everybody will tell you, everyone will tell you, there is a visual learner, there's an auditory learner. You know, you can see the people process information differently. This one is interested in halakha, the other one is interested in Kabbalah, this one is interested in physics, the other one is in literature. You can't just bulldoze everybody out. And this is what they start to understand in education, yet they're very far from actually implementing that. When I keep saying to you all the time, special education should not be served only for education, special education kid. Every kid deserves special education. In special education, they implement that more. But, you know, it should be to everybody like this. Anyway, so the end of the parasha is very tragic, but yet there is hope. And hope will come only throughout change. We almost finished. And maybe, despise, or maybe because of the great crisis, that sometimes it forces us to actually implement change. It seems that Yitzchak and Rivka, regardless of that, are on the same page when it comes to their sons marrying a certain type of girls, and they're quite criticizing, they're critical of the way Esav is choosing his wife, and they are on the same page in terms of sending Yaakov out of here, as they say. So Yaakov is going to the Galut, is going to exile, and that exile forces Yaakov Avinu to go through an internal change, to change himself internally, which is a tremendous, and it's a deep change from side to side. A person, and I'll pay attention to what I told you before, a person that we called upon him, Ishtam, a simple person, a naive person, Yoshev Ohalim, sits in tents, all of a sudden needs to wander away from home, far away from home. He needs to go basically from the middle of Israel all the way to the border of Turkey. This is quite of a distance. It's far. And he walks it all by foot. He needs to change from a person who sits down and look at books. You know, he has those fine little hands, beautiful hands like this. All of a sudden, he has to be a shepherd that sleeps outside, that deals with sheep. He deals with cold, with weather, with bad animals. He needs to give up his naiveness, dealing with a crook like his uncle Lavan. Now reality makes him change to become, to deal with the complete opposite of what he is. I'm trying to tell you something. Pay attention because it's very important to you. The way you live and the things you experience in your life. And on the other hand, Esav, all of a sudden, Esav, who's trying to make peace with his parents, right? He marries the daughters of Ishmael. And we'll see later on, and I do believe that Esav really wanted to make peace with Yaakov. And look at this, that Esav actually spends all these years by his parents. He's the one who's sitting down. Yaakov that was sitting down all these years, all of a sudden they switch the roles. And Esav is taking care of his parents. Esav is there and Yaakov is going out to who knows where. Did you ever wonder why is that? They were opposites. They were twins. They were the same thing of two sides. And you can't be all here. You have to be balanced. And in order to balance things out, that's what happens. Everything was reversed. Which is very interesting also, I want to tell you. We always forget that. After that case, Rivka is not mentioned anymore. We only say that when her main naked, died, that's when she dies, you know, which is like 12 chapters further down the road. She's not mentioned anymore, not alive, not dead, and we say only may naked. And then the, no. In any case, if this is the case, if this is how things are, so therefore our parasha is basically an X-ray or MRI image of a human phenomena which is very, very detrimental to our lives. You have to understand that we always take a part in a certain happening that is happening. We are actors and players in many games that are happening in many times, all the time. What do I mean? You are a parent. At the same time, you are a child. The same times you work with people, you have you're a husband, you are a worker, you're a boss, all these games, all these maneuvers happen all the time from all aspects from you, all the time. It's not that, okay, I'm going to sit here, I'm going to sit down, and you should know that many people feel this overwhelming anxiety and they basically choose to say, you know what, I don't want to do anything with my life. I want to sit home, right? When I asked this guy today, what would you like to do in your life? He says, nothing. I would like to sit home and sleep. Remember? And I said, what do you mean you want to sit home and sleep? Maybe you should work at Sleepy's. It's overwhelming to them, this whole thing. How can you be all these things at one time? And that's what we need to understand. And it's and the relationship and the interaction that we have is very complex. Because if you have a partner, let's say for example you are my partner, right? And we're coming to work together. But we're not just coming to work together, just you and me, leave everything behind. You had a good day with your wife, I had a bad day with my wife, you had a good day with this one, I had a bad day with this one, the other way around, this one smiled to me, the other one didn't smile to you. And we're coming like this to work, and now we have to deal with each other. It's very complex, very complicated. And we have an assumption that naturally we're leaning, and it's quite wrong, that causes us many times to wrongly judge whatever is happening. Or we assume many things. We don't like to look at things the way they are. We assume. And that assumption is a killer to us. And that kind of a leaning, it's called anochi, selfishness, ani, which is us all the time. I only see things from my point of view, from my perspective. I cannot see his perspective. For example, Yitzchak is not sleeping. Why? He's tired. So he's closing his eyes. It's okay, don't worry, Motek. I understand that he's tired, but if I didn't understand that, I would yell at him. Okay, go to sleep. It's okay, he's tired. You can't look at things only from your perspective. You gotta understand that the other person also is very complex, is also has a point of view, and sometimes his perspective is just as valid as your perspective. Because whatever happened to him, he saw certain things, and whatever happened to you, you saw certain things. Look at Rivka and Yitzchak. The greatness of Yitzchak is able to say, okay, you know, it's not a problem, you're right. I'll give him a bracha, right? I think it was Woody Allen that says, when I always see football players, certain in the circle, you know, what do you call it?
Huddle.
Huddling together, right? And they always, I always think that they're talking about me, right? Well, paranoid. Why? Because you always, the whole world is about you. And if two people are talking, they're probably talking about you. A typical New York Jew, right? And our parasha shows us exactly the opposite. That there are many different ways to look at things. And I think that ultimately, oh, nice to see you. 5 minutes to midnight, Cinderella. Our parasha comes to show us that there are other things that, you know, other possibilities, other things that could happen, it's really not, it's not always for us or against us or about us and so on and so forth. And we could see it in many different ways. And you could see things even on a national level, right? Argument's sake, and don't jump on me, you know how I feel about the land of Israel and the Jews. However, I can tell you this, let's just put it to the side. You have those Arabs which are not Palestinians. They call themselves Palestinians. But let's say they have their point of view and we have our point of view. Did you ever bother to ask about the Native Americans, the Indians, and the way they feel about Americans? We only know how we feel about them. Cowboys, Indians. Indians always die. You know, the dream of most Native Americans is all the white people will take the stuff and ship themselves to wherever they came from. It doesn't make a difference. You could be for 500 years. You are foreign. You got to get out of here. There's a certain point, and their point is valid. And how do I deal with it? How do I make the best of it, right? And the same thing when you have arguments, for example, with your wife. She has a point of view, and you have a point of view. And it doesn't mean that one side always have to accept the other side. That's not a healthy relationship. Both sides need to understand that their arguments are legitimate, and let's allow, because we really want to work it out together. It's not about who's going, this argument who's going to control the relationship really belongs to small people. The need of a person to always be on top is a sign of a very small and weak person. Always. That's why if you go into an argument, don't yell. When you yell, nobody hears you. And you're yelling because you don't want to be heard, because maybe your points don't make any sense. Sometimes a person yells out of frustration, and then the other person doesn't understand. But they're yelling, it's not really like them. They're probably feeling very frustrated. So it says, okay, you know what? Let's see what this is all about. Try to work things out. And, you know, things are evolving, you know, on a national level, on a family level, on a community level, and so on and so forth. And we need to understand that even our children are part of a other or greater scheme of events that happens, because our kids also go to school. And they have their own problems, and they have their own issues, and they have their own point of view. It's not always ours. But Yitzchak, he might be in the middle. Yitzchak might be in the middle, right? But Yitzchak is not selfish. Yitzchak is not selfish. And we need to understand that when you accept upon yourself that reality or the truthfulness of the reality of others as well, you're really going to be able to have what we call a chavat adat, and you're going to have shalvat and nefesh. You're going to be more relaxed. You don't have to be so uptight about everything. And nobody always is always out there to get you. And nobody's trying to stumble you. Nobody's trying to hurt you. And you could be less paranoid. You have less anxiety. When you have less anxiety and paranoia, you'll become more tranquilo. And you don't need to drink, and you don't need to smoke. Drinking, smoking, drugs is a very bad excuse to deal with problems. It actually teaches you how not to deal with problems. That's why if you are stressed at work, or you are stressed or whatever, when you come home, do not drink. Do not. If you see a person that comes home and has a cup of whiskey as it comes home, you know there is something detrimentally wrong, something fundamentally wrong there, and you need to help them. It's a cry for help. The person at that moment, when he takes his vodka or whatever he's taking, he's basically medicating himself. He can't deal with that. So he drinks to take, as they say, to take the edge off. Or people who smoke pot. It's the most stupid thing in the world. Don't legalize pot, legalize common sense. Help people. You're making a whole generation of morons out there. Pot is bad. I don't care what anybody says. You can't be spiritual smoking, you can't be spiritual stoned, you can't be spiritual drunk. You're just the opposite of it. You roll in your vomit like a behemoth. It can't be. You can't call yourself a spiritual person or drink all the Hasidim, lechaim, fabrengen. It's not it. They gave him just the alcohol. Yalla, tiyeh Hasid, kabel alcohol bechinam. Get free alcohol, become a Hasid. It's shtuyot. I'll go to the meal and give you sponge cake and like warm vodka. What are you out of your mind? And then you're happy. You're not happy. Because when you wake up, when you sober up from your drunkenness, the problems become bigger because you haven't dealt with them. Problems don't become smaller, they become bigger. Just like your prostate. If you know what I mean. And then you have big problems. And you take care of things, but you take care of them. You have to understand. And sometimes, and that's also the fear that we have about getting old. People are not willing to accept that we're getting old. So they fight them. And you have a woman, she's 17 years old, she dressed up like a 16-year-old bimbo. It's ridiculous. Or a guy who is like also 70 years old, he works with a speedo. I mean, give me a break, spare me, you know? Wear something classy. Wear, I don't know, some nice suit, some, you know, act your age. Not in your mind. Learn, exercise, but act a certain way. That's the fear we have. We're not willing to accept the reality, not of other people and not of ourselves. So we, all our life, creating resistance. We're pushing. We're pushing other people's reality. We're not willing to accept anybody's opinion. Look, for example, liberals, right? Liberals always, they don't want to hear anybody. Everybody's wrong, they're always right. It's a fear. It shows small-mindedness. Not willing to accept somebody else's opinion. Or other people's reality. Or reality itself. Let's talk a little bit about Kabbalah now, and then we'll finish. So the parasha tells us, what teaches us the secret of what is so-called Sod HaYipuch, Sod HaMa'apach, the hustle takeover, the turnaround, the reversal of things. How to change things that seems to us unchangeable. How to take not natural and make it natural. Yitzchak, Rivka, Yaakov, Esav are images, are figures, the work for one thing. It's called Tikkun Olam, fixing the world, are forces who also work inside of us. Remember I told you, they are one entity. So you take the symbolism of the twins and they exist within you inside. Each and every one of us has the Yitzchak inside of him, has the Yaakov, has the Esav, has the Rivka inside of him. Each and every one of us. These are not just people. These are forces that operate inside of each and every one of us. And the Sefer Netivot Shalom talks about how this is really is connected to our time. And he writes the following. Ki HaKadosh Baruch Hu, because HaKadosh Baruch Hu created all the reality, the essence of Am Yisrael lemala min ha-teva, above the laws of nature. Avraham gave birth to Yitzchak above the nature. He was 100 years old. Yitzchak olidet Yaakov lemala min ha-teva. Also, they couldn't bear children. That the whole existence of Am Yisrael is above nature, to show us that the Kadosh Baruch Hu conducts Am Yisrael in a supernatural fashion, or in a not natural way. So therefore, you have to remember this. Also, when we are stuck in situation in our lives, that it seems that by the common sense of nature, it is impossible to seek or receive salvation. There's no chance for help. It's very important to us to know and understand that we all have the potential and the ability to connect to a place that is higher than nature, to connect to HaKadosh Baruch Hu, and this is the opening in which all the forefathers, whether Avraham, Yitzchak, and Yaakov, kind of opened up for us. It's like a secret opening. That if we'll be able to understand that, we can penetrate through and understand and overcome that. It is very important to understand, because we all go through some difficult times that seems impossible for a human to go over. And we need to remember, that's why there is tefillah, that's why it was important for all the avot to institute in each and every one of us the three times prayers, Avraham Shacharit, Yitzchak Mincha, and Yaakov Arvid, to pray. Prayer is an opening. It's like a wedge that opens it out that you're able to speak to HaKadosh Baruch Hu and speak out to Him. It's important to pray. That's why it's important to pray on time. That's why it's important to pray appropriately. That's why it's important to pray. Period. To understand that. And each and every one of us has the obligation of Avodah to do whatever we can to do. According to nature and not according to nature, right? Why? Because every person is enslaved to the need to receive. We always like to receive. I like to receive gifts. I love to receive freebies and so on and so forth. Coupons. Now we always know that. We all have our own private desires, whatever the desires will be, which is a natural way. A natural way in which all of us were created. We're created with desires, right? One person would like to have a 22-ounce steak. The other one would like to have an apple. This one likes sushi. The other one's like ice cream. Everybody has different desires. So the Kabbalah teaches us what we are obligated to work on is to be able to take our wills, our desires, and our will to receive in order to turn it and to make it in order to receive, but for another reason, to receive in order to give, to be mashpia, to influence. I want an ability, but to do something. For example, when Shlomo HaMelech asked for HaKadosh Baruch Hu, he said, Ribbono Shel Olam, how could I need your people? I need your help. Give me great wisdom so I could appropriately lead your people. HaKadosh Baruch Hu says, I'll give you not only the wisdom, I'll give you also monetary things. You need to understand that. He wants to receive, but in order to give. And that's something very, very important. To be able to, the person needs to understand that the essence of us as humans is to be able to turn ourselves from a receiver to a giver, from selfish to selfless. And the way of each and every one of us is tremendous tests and you know, on our way. And when we'll be able to overcome those, and we're going to awaken what we call the Teva Elyon, the upper, the true nature of us as Jews, of the neshama of a Jew, is basically to be able to overcome our own self-desire, what we call the Yetzer Hara, to be able to bring to the light the bad. And now pay attention. We just had Rosh Chodesh Kislev. Hanukkah is coming 25 days, enough for nothing. We have this parasha now. We have to bring about, and everybody needs to understand, there's a tzaddik hiding in each and every one of us. And yes, there is sometimes the rasha that lives inside of us. And we need to understand that this parasha gives us the derech, the way, and the ability, and the strength to change, to act, to make this internal change inside of us. Each of them, and you should know, every Jew has this ability to do so. So this is the you know, the month where, you know, Kislev is the month where the nights are the darkest. Shabbat is at 4:10, Rabotai. Candle lighting is at 4:10. That's this week and next week is the shortest Shabbatot. 4:10, darkness, and towards the great darkness, all of a sudden comes Chanukah. Chanukah starts with a little candle. And we bring the light about. And we need to understand, just like the Maccabim did, at the darkest point of Am Yisrael, they start bringing the light out. And this is what it's called, Yitaron Ha'or Me'achoshech. The advantage that light has over darkness. And the advantage is by finding light in the darkness. HaKadosh Baruch Hu put the order in everything. According to Kabbalah, there is a concept that's called klipa kadma lepri. First the husk, then the pri, right? Or in Kabbalah, it's called chashucha vehadar nehora. Darkness and then light. And he says, as it says in Sefer Bereshit, vayi erev, vayi boker. First is going to be dark, then there's going to be light. How is going to be light? If you're going to bring it to the light, if you're going to find it, if you're going to understand that you need to connect to HaKadosh Baruch Hu in everything you do, and everything comes from HaKadosh Baruch Hu, and you need to understand that you have Yetzer Tov, and you also have Yetzer Ra. You have to understand that you cannot kill the Yetzer Ra, but you can turn it to become Yetzer Tov. How? By bringing on the light. You can't just become a tzaddik like that. You don't go to a course or get a diploma or go to college, become a PhD in tzaddikus. You have to bring more light. When you bring in more light, not only to your life, to your actions, mimele, the darkness, becomes light altogether. And that's a big secret. Everything that grows starts with rotten. You put a seed in the ground, the seed rots, and then it grows. That's exactly the idea behind it. And Chazal says HaKadosh Baruch Hu is a tov v'amitiv, he is good for us and he shows us and so on and so forth. The problem is that to every gift that we get, any gift that we get, there's always a certain sense of embarrassment, right? And in what we call Nahamad de Chisufa, bread of embarrassment. So if you get it for free, it's going to be embarrassed. So you're not going to do it. Therefore, Rabotai, we need to work hard and we need to earn our gifts. It's okay to work hard. A person needs to understand to work hard. And we need to understand that only when we're able to understand that, we'll be able to conquer the darkness. How? By working very hard, especially when it's hard for you, when things are not easy. Look at David HaMelech. He find a Kadosh Baruch Hu, closeness to a Kadosh Baruch Hu, when it was most difficult to you. Most people are close to a Kadosh Baruch Hu only when a Kadosh Baruch Hu gives them and they see blessing in their actions. But when things are bad, why did you do this to me? And so on and so forth. That's not the way to go. That's not how you're going to bring darkness into light. On the contrary, we need to be able to understand that first we need to take care of the problem. Then we can actually enjoy it. When you invest in your kids, it's hard, but then you'll be able to enjoy them. First you deal, you want to eat a fruit. You want to eat a good fruit. What do? You have to first of all break the shell, the outside. Then you can take the sweet fruit inside. If you don't do it like this, it's going to be a problem for you, regardless of how good it is inside. So remember that. It's a tremendous spiritual parasha with a lot of hints and ideas of how to work on ourselves spiritually. I would tell you the following. If it's not boring to you, listen to what I told you again. Listen to it again and listen to it again. And try to find this koach, the strength inside of you, to recognize what's good and what's bad in you, what's good and what's bad in others. Recognize that and then bring the good about. When you do so, you feel so connected to HaKadosh Baruch Hu. Don't forget that everything can turn around. If you sit in tents one day, you can go to work, and then you're going to work and you can come to learn. You need both of them. You need both of them. But the light that we are talking about always is the light of Torah. That's why a person needs to dedicate himself to work hard on learning Torah, to live the words of Torah, to connect heaven and earth. Connecting heaven and earth is only through the glue of the light of Torah. Yei ratzon b'fnei HaKadosh Baruch Hu that we should all be married, to see the good, to feel the good, to see HaKadosh Baruch Hu, and Shabbat Shalom and Rosh Chodesh Tov.